He's faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. And able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. But just how much science fact is there behind this comic book superstar? How could any being, even one from another planet, fly, bend steel with his bare hands, and possess X-ray vision? All without smashing the unbreakable laws of physics. The Man of Steel's superpowers are put to the ultimate test of strength when we reveal the secrets behind the science of Superman.
So with the super hearing, does he hear each sound by itself or everything all at once?
Both.
He's certainly a lot taller than I thought.
6'4".
I love that he can see through anything. I'd have fun with that.
Anything but lead.
I bet he's
225 pounds, faster than a speeding bullet, draws his power from the sun, invulnerable to anything but kryptonite, and he never lies.
Kryptonite?
Radioactive pieces of his homeworld.
Lois, how tall would you say Clark is?
215 pounds.
From Hollywood blockbusters to comic books and television shows, Superman, the world's first comic book superhero, hasn't been shy about showing off his amazing abilities. But believe it or not, the Man of Steel has also been responsible for exposing millions of fans to a surprising number of scientific principles, like gravity, the power of X-rays, acoustics, speed, ballistics, and the dangers of radiation, to name just a few. But to really understand the science behind Superman, it's best to go back to the beginning. All the way back to the planet Krypton. According to the comics, Superman's home planet was massive, much larger than Earth. Born Kal-El, Superman was the son of a brilliant scientist who had made a shocking discovery that Krypton's dense core was unstable and about to explode.
Much as I dread uttering these fateful words, I have come to the conclusion that Krypton is about to be destroyed.
Here he is, Jor-El.
You have him well wrapped?
Yes. He's so good. Not even a whimper.
The story of Superman's origins has been told and retold numerous times. But it took a former college physics student turned comic book writer named Mark Waid to inject some super science into the story for his 2005 graphic novel, Superman, Birthright.
If there's something super dense about the core, it makes the core of the planet naturally very unstable and highly radioactive, because the denser a material is, the higher it falls in the periodic table.
Now imagine a planet that's got a core packed with dense elements like uranium or plutonium. And you've got the formula for a massive explosion. And that's just what happened. Seconds after Superman's father and mother sent their only son into space, some 3 million light years away toward Earth. But why Earth? Simple. Here Kal-El would be the strongest kid on the block, possessing powers he didn't have back on Krypton. On Earth, he would be a Superman. How? Well, during the character's early comic book days, the explanation for those superpowers could be summed up in a single word: gravity.
They gave Superman a scientific explanation for his powers. He was born on Krypton, where the gravity was greater, and therefore, you know, he grew up being stronger.
But how does gravity affect strength, speed, and the ability to leap tall buildings in a single bound? Think for a minute about our moon. Because it's smaller than Earth, the moon's gravity is just 1/6 that of our own planet. And less gravity means a change in a person's relative weight. For example, a human being's weight on the moon is much less than on Earth. That's why astronauts can leap moon rocks in a single bound.
There we go.
He
you have someone who weighs, say, 200 pounds on Earth and put them on the moon, which has 1/6 Earth gravity, they would weigh 1/6 of 200 pounds.
Because Superman came from a planet with a far greater gravitational pull than that of Earth, it stands to reason that, for him, leaping tall buildings would be like a game of hopscotch.
If you want to compare the gravity of Krypton to the gravity of Earth, you know, to make Superman do some reasonable things, you're looking at roughly 1,000 times the gravity of Earth.
A gravity 1,000 times that of Earth would mean that if Superman weighed 200 pounds here, he would weigh 200,000 pounds on Krypton.
If Superman landed on Jupiter or any other planet where the gravity is a lot heavier, instead of being like the most powerful being on the planet, he might have been the last one picked for dodgeball.
Superman!
But the difference between Krypton's gravity and that of our Earth presents Superman with another scientific dilemma. When he assumes his secret identity as newspaper reporter Clark Kent, Superman seems to have no problem walking around Earth at a normal pace, which directly challenges the laws of gravity.
One of the greatest surprises is Superman's apparent mastery of 1G, Earth's gravitational acceleration at the surface. When we think about our astronauts walking on the moon, they're bouncing around, they look like they're in slow motion. That's how Superman should appear on planet Earth.
Now, crush this with your hand.
Another scientific mystery is why Superman's muscles don't weaken over time, like those of astronauts who spend long periods in zero gravity.
How's that?
Could it be because he's from a planet with so much more gravity that his muscles have evolved to be much stronger than ours?
You live on a world with a certain amount of gravity, you need a certain amount of force to stand up, to lift things, to jump. He would have a much greater weight there. He would come here, he'd be able to lift much heavier objects. And again, it goes roughly with gravity, so it'd be about 1,000 times stronger.
Superman's arrival on Earth as a child may also have made it easier for him to adapt his powerful muscles to our planet's lesser gravity, and allowed him to slowly flex those muscles over time.
As he grows up, he starts to discover, wow, I can jump really, really high. Oh, wait a minute. If I choose, I don't ever need to touch the Earth. I can actually defy gravity.
But it did take Superman some time to master what many consider his greatest superpower, flight. In fact, it's a power he didn't even have when he debuted in the comics in 1938. At first, the Man of Steel could only leap, 1/8 of a mile to be exact.
Up in the sky, look!
It's a bird!
It's a plane! It's Superman!
But by the 1940s, Superman had become a full-fledged frequent flyer. Which raises another question. Can gravity alone explain this phenomenal superpower?
For Superman to fly in constant level flight, he has to have a thrust force that equals his drag force, and he has to have a lift that equals his weight in order to be balanced up and down, right and left. We see no obvious propulsion means for Superman. How does he overcome the drag force? That's the mystery of his flight.
Over the years, Superman has found some different ways to get off the ground. In the 1950s television series starring George Reeves, Superman would have to gather speed before lifting himself into the air, just like a jet plane. He also bounced, taking full advantage of Earth's lesser gravity to achieve height, speed, and distance. In other incarnations, Superman could simply lift himself off the ground and fly anywhere, even at super speeds. But the difference between Earth's gravity and that of Krypton could no longer explain this remarkable ability.
This is my theory. The flying is based on the magnetic content of his body and the Earth's polarity. So he could push himself away and pull himself towards it.
Actually, magnetism might be a plausible explanation. Magnets are used in certain types of high-speed trains, where a magnet is placed on the bottom of the vehicle and a magnet of the same polarity is placed on a track below it. The two magnets use force to propel themselves apart, lifting the vehicle off the ground. But there just might be another explanation for Superman's ability to fly. one that involves a speculative theory actually being studied by scientists here on Earth.
There are some theories that gravity is carried by subatomic particles that are called gravitons. Gravitons are something we have not yet detected. Theoretically, they would travel in waves, much like light waves or electromagnetic waves. If Superman has a way of generating gravitons within his own body, assuming that gravitons exist, I would say he would be flying by essentially riding waves of gravity that are in his immediate environment.
Now, thinking about flying is one thing.
Here we go, man. Rolling.
But if you're a movie maker, how do you convince modern-day audiences that a man actually can travel through the air?
Roll back again, folks.
For the 2006 release, Superman Returns, director Bryan Singer set out to bring as much realism as possible to the movie's flying scenes, with the help of the film star, Brandon Routh.
I knew flying was going to be a challenging experience, but I didn't realize how much of an athlete I was going to have to be.
A way that we experimented with how the body moves in flight is we had Brandon swimming in a pool, and he's quite a good swimmer. And he would push off from one wall of the swimming pool, but because he was swimming, he'd be suspended, and then his body would exhibit strength or resistance in certain ways. We would take video of this and then use that as a reference.
Of course, there's more to Superman than just flying over global real estate. Much more. For instance, what does it really take to be the strongest and fastest man on Earth? When Superman saves ace reporter Lois Lane from a fall in Superman the Movie, starring Christopher Reeve and Margot Kidder, he utters one of the greatest pickup lines in the history of cinema.
Easy, miss. I've got you.
You've got me? Who's got you?
He also performs one of the most dangerous of all his acts of heroism. The fact is, if Lois was falling more than 30 stories and was grabbed suddenly in mid-flight, Superman probably wouldn't be doing her any favors.
So here's Lois Lane falling down. She's going to hit the ground with some speed. Probably it'll be the terminal velocity, which is the fastest you can fall, because the air resistance will slow you down, gravity will try and speed you up, and you'll hit some constant speed. It'll be about 120 miles per hour. Now, Superman's fairly far away somewhere, so he's got to go much faster than she's falling, because she's falling a short distance, he's flying from far away. He's going to be going maybe 1,000 times faster than Lois Lane, 120,000 miles per hour, something like that, okay? So when he hits Lois Lane, she's going to feel a change in speed that's 1,000 times bigger than the change in speed she gets when she hits the ground. So it's 1,000 times more painful to get hit by Superman flying in and grabbing her than just to hit the ground.
Well, I certainly hope this little incident hasn't put you off flying, miss. Statistically speaking, of course, it's still the safest way to travel.
Bye!
In order to catch falling female reporters, Superman not only has to be strong and gentle, he's also got to be fast. Real fast. Literally faster, as they say, than a speeding bullet. And not just in the air, but also on the ground. On Smallville, young Clark Kent, as played by Tom Welling, can handle supersonic speeds. At times, he moves so fast, he seems to be invisible.
One of the things that we have to balance is how much what he does has an impact on the world around him. For instance, if he runs at super speed, is he running supersonically? And if so, does he generate a boom? We don't really want to go there because part of what he does is get in and out of a room really quickly and pretty much silently. So we do cheat that.
God.
We actually played if you were the naked human eye in the room and he went and zipped around, you couldn't see him. Obviously on television, to see it, you see a bit of a blur. And sometimes we have what we call Clark time, which is when you see him moving and everything else in slow motion. Again, visually, to see the different sides of these superpowers.
But what kind of physiology would Superman need to have in order for his body to move at such super speeds?
For Superman to run at the great velocities that he does, he would need to have a muscular system far superior to ours and joints with less friction than our joints. If we were to move our limbs at the speeds he does, the joints would heat up and we would simply degrade the joint. Our bone tissue and articular cartilages would not be able to withstand those sorts of accelerations.
To find a reason for Superman's incredible resilience, you won't have to look up in the sky. Instead, just look under your feet at the skeletal structure of insects.
The insect has a chitinous exoskeleton, much like our fingernail, but in many instances denser. Superman would have to have virtually an exoskeleton that allows him great flexibility, but the capacity to withstand impacts.
Hello, Bates.
Hello, Superman.
You don't seem very surprised to see me.
Well, being a wrongdoer, I figured sooner or later you gotta catch me.
Even in the 1930s, Superman comic books compared the strength of the Man of Steel to the durability of insects. But even the toughest bug can't take a bullet the way Superman can.
To me, he's the Man of Steel. And I thought, well, if he's really the Man of Steel, every fiber of his body has a kind of imperviousness to it. And I thought, you know, okay, what's a truly vulnerable area? Well, it would be the eye. We've seen bullets bounce off his chest, but we haven't seen them bounce off his face. Why not just go all the way?
If Superman's molecular makeup is so tough, wouldn't it be impossible for him to shave or even cut his hair?
In the 1950s, Superman comics started running letter columns, kids asking questions like, okay, dude, how does Superman get his hair cut if he's invulnerable? And so the answer became that that he fooled all the barbers in town into believing that he was actually secretly bald, but don't tell anybody, because I don't want anybody, any other kids, to make fun of me. And then he would go off into his secret cavern, and he would use mirrors and heat vision to sort of give himself a quick trim.
Most people don't know that the Fortress of Solitude came with a shaving kit and all the things you'd basically find in a W hotel.
Here, cheers.
Believe it or not, Superman wasn't always so invincible. His powers have actually increased over time, as readers and audiences expected more and more from their favorite superhero.
At first, he was susceptible to poison gases, high voltages of electricity. But over the years, as you need to write more and more stories about this character, you need to have him go up against greater and greater threats and sort of up the odds.
Okay, so let's accept the fact that Superman has become virtually indestructible over the years. But that doesn't explain why his costume is, too. After all, it doesn't seem to tear, stain, or even wrinkle.
It was always destructible in the early days, but it was decided that it's kind of a drag to think about Superman having to go home every night and restitching up the cape and the tights.
In the 1950s television series, the writers cooked up a brilliant explanation for the indestructibility of Superman's famous suit.
There's a baby in it!
Land sakes alive!
The suit was made by his adoptive Earth parents, the Kents, out of the Kryptonian blanket that accompanied baby Kal-El to Earth.
Here. Burn much?
Not burned at all. Blanket ain't even scorched.
The Kents said, well, let's take these blankets that shotguns can't blast through and dynamite can't blow up and see if we can reweave them into something. Using Clark's heat vision, they would sever the threads, and eventually they became his super suit.
We do have carbon fiber materials that are very dense, relatively flexible, But Superman's costume has been used to cloak innocent people from hazards. I don't have an explanation as to the nature of the material that could do that.
So we've established that Superman really is more powerful than a locomotive. But since we're on the subject, just how powerful is a locomotive?
The power of a locomotive is about 6,500 horsepower. That's about 5.5 million watts. If you could convert all that to electricity, that'd be enough to run 50,000 100-watt light bulbs.
Think about light for a second. It's a source of both energy and power. So it just might be that the source of Superman's amazing strength is the sun itself. This theory, found in the comic books, suggests that Earth's yellow sun emits more intense wavelengths of radiation than Krypton's slowly dying red sun.
This is my favorite rationale of Superman's powers. He's exposed to solar energy of the sort that his body was just not built to absorb. So instead, he takes it in, and that's where his super strength comes from.
Superman might have skin that has the capacity for a modified photovoltaic quality, that is, to take sunlight and convert it into electrical energy. We have an analogous system in our body. We use radiation from our sun, and we make vitamin D in our skin as a consequence of sunlight.
We've evolved to take advantage of our yellow sun with photosynthesis in plants, absorbing vitamin D from sunlight. Over billions of years, all plants and animals on Earth have been optimized for the yellow star we see in the sky.
If Kryptonian hemoglobin was more similar to chlorophyll or more efficient in some ways than ours, Superman could just take in sunlight and convert it directly to food. People are working on research along these lines, and it may be possible someday to have solar-powered human beings. It's a question of altering certain genetic factors in the DNA, turning on certain genes that may do this.
But there's just one problem with this yellow sun versus red sun business. Scientifically speaking, it doesn't hold up to the light of day.
The difference between a red and a yellow star is not going to be huge. You're just going to get a little bit more or less energy, and it's not at all clear how that would translate to more or less strength.
But if Superman's strength, speed, and indestructibility might be the result of yellow suns and gravitational forces, there are still some physical characteristics that aren't so easy to explain. Like most things about Superman, there's more to him than meets the naked eye.
Whoa, Kent, are you all right? Kent, what happened up there?
Ask your typical teen which of Superman's powers they'd want the most, and chances are they'd say X-ray vision.
Yeah, if I'd had X-ray vision in high school, I would be doing this interview from prison.
For us, X-rays are as familiar as a trip to the doctor's office. But there's a big difference between the way those X-rays work and the kind created by Superman. In the real world, when a doctor or dentist takes an X-ray, a photographic plate is put behind the part of a patient's body getting examined. After a very brief exposure to the ray, an image is recorded that is otherwise unavailable to the human eye. But Superman doesn't need a photographic plate in order to see things. He sees them just by looking at them.
For Superman to use his X-ray vision, you would have to have a system where he generates X-rays, they go out, they go through what he wants to see, they hit something that actually reflects X-rays, which there's not a lot of stuff around on the planet that does, it bounces back and then he detects it again.
But Superman's X-ray vision does have one limitation, just like the machine at your doctor's office.
What color underwear am I wearing? Oh, I'm sorry, I embarrassed you, didn't I?
No, I don't know, Flynn. It's just that this platter must be made of lead.
Yes, it is, so.
Oh, you see, I sort of have a problem seeing through lead.
X-rays cannot penetrate lead pretty much because of the density of the material. This attribute of lead is used in hospitals, dental offices, because you want to limit the amount of X-rays you get exposed to.
Everyone seems to think there's something very valuable in one of those knives.
And you're going to examine them with your X-ray vision?
That's correct.
We better stand back. We could be burned by the ray bombardment. So intense.
That's quite correct. As a matter of fact, you better all wait in the hall.
Superman's X-ray vision would be harmful if it was powerful, like a high dose type thing. There might be a scenario where his X-ray vision was low enough power, it didn't really cause damage. But most likely, the X-ray vision would slowly cause damage if he kept looking at the same person over and over.
Well, looks like you're all wrong. There's absolutely nothing hidden in any one of those knives.
The first time, I thought I was hallucinating, and then it happened again.
Clark, I'm sure there's some way to control this.
You guys, I can see through things. How do you control that?
Of course, for filmmakers, showing Superman's ability to see through solid objects presents some definite creative challenges.
What we tried to do on Smallville that was different from the movies or the other TV shows was, you know, X-ray vision looked like an X-ray. It wasn't see-through vision, like the craggly hole in the wall and he could see through it. It was actually look like if you were looking at a
live X-ray.
A live X-ray.
In the movie Superman Returns, director Bryan Singer chose yet another cinematic approach in order to illustrate Superman's unique visual ability.
In our film, his X-ray vision is not simply X-ray vision. It's more like an MRI or a CAT scan. It kind of dices and slices through things at his own discretion so that he's able to look into your body and separate your bones from your heart, from your liver, and find out what's wrong and make judgments.
But maybe the Man of Steel is flexing a different sort of scientific muscle.
Superman might use a sound wave energy system that, much like a sonogram, goes through materials and bounces back, and we get an understanding of the density of those materials, and we perceive that as X-ray vision, when in fact it's really a very modified sonar.
But Superman's superpowers of sight don't end with X-ray vision. He can also clearly see objects from extraordinary distances, just like a telescope.
I think I'll just go see if Ricky's all right. You okay?
Yeah.
We have photoreceptors on the back of our eye, and then we have a lens that focuses the light onto these photoreceptors. And so the quality of the lens and the number and sensitivity of the photoreceptors will enable a being like Superman to see many, many times farther than we can.
If you think super sight can only exist in comic books, think again. In our world, some birds, like eagles for example, can see much more sharply than humans. This is due to the fact that they have more light-sensitive cells in their retina, at least 4 times more than we do. But even if Superman had 100 times more light receptors in his eyes than humans, it wouldn't explain another of his extraordinary ocular abilities, heat vision.
His heat vision is essentially laser vision. It was created in the 1960s and made its own separate superpower.
If you wanted to make a laser for Superman in his eyes, you need a very high power source. And typically, Superman's trying to melt stuff with his heat vision. But you need a fair amount of power to melt something quickly, so it would be unlikely to be able to generate enough energy, I think. But it's not completely inconceivable.
I was trying to explain to Brandon how he has heat vision. I said, well, in my mind, you draw solar energy and you collect a high concentration of it in a billion micromirrors inside of your eyeballs. And at will, you dispense it.
There are animals like the electric eel that do store charge and can emit a great deal of electricity. Superman may be able to emit some charge field of such a powerful nature that it goes beyond the body, goes beyond physical contact that the electric eel needs, and actually goes through air and space to have an impact on another body.
Okay, so assuming Superman can store energy like an electric eel, he just might be able to scorch objects just by blinking his baby blue eyes. Fortunately, Making sense out of the Man of Steel's super senses is a little more plausible when discussing his super hearing.
Nathan, everything's set. As soon as I'm out, get rid of the Ross kid. There will be his planet, Metropolis.
Superman would have to have a very, very sensitive ear mechanism that could be very much designed after ours. Superman may have a tympanic membrane, a specialized eardrum that takes even the tiniest of sounds and translates them into the sound energy that's sent to our brain.
Another of the Man of Steel's superpowers involves the most basic ability of all, breathing, or in his case, super breathing.
Super breath is his ability to take in a certain volume of air, a great volume of air, compress it in his lungs like a super compressor.
We can put the air in this room in a very small tank, like a scuba tank. So maybe what Superman can do is take a deep breath with this powerful musculature and have it compressed much like a scuba tank. And then when necessary or when he wants to, perhaps he blows this air out with a vengeance.
Super breath is great to have. Of course you will need a super toothbrush and perhaps some super dentine.
Okay, let's assume that Superman, as seen here in Lois and Clark starring Dean Cain, can use super breath to put out fires or even freeze objects. But does someone have to be from Krypton in order to change the temperature of their breath?
You can do this demo at home. If you purse your lips and blow, you'll feel cool air. If you just breathe with open mouth, it's warm air. It's the difference in how your mouth forms and that tiny orifice coming out that forms the cool air.
We've all done it with soup. He just does it to a super extent. Hot. Cold.
If Superman has super breath, he must have super lungs and need oxygen just like humans. But if that's the case, how can we explain his ability to fly into the upper stratosphere or even into outer space? Is Superman so invincible that he doesn't even need oxygen to stay alive? It's one thing to read about Superman's superpowers in a comic book. It's another to see them dramatized in a movie or television series. In Superman 4, The Quest for Peace, the Man of Steel, as played by Christopher Reeve, seems to have no trouble at all walking on the moon and hurling a net full of nuclear bombs into the sun.
Even though Superman's a superhero, he probably wouldn't do too well in space without him. Pressure suit or an oxygen mask. In the zero vacuum conditions of space, your blood would boil, the oxygen would leave your body, be a very painful and horrible death.
Superman also might want to take it easy when he takes Lois Lane out on a date high above Metropolis. If he isn't careful about how high he flies, the lack of oxygen and the cold temperatures could present a problem for his passenger.
Couldn't take them really high. I'm talking airliner altitudes. Because as we know, climbing mountains on Earth, for example, like Everest, 10,000, 20,000 feet, the air gets pretty thin up there.
Lois was scantily clad for a lot of that flying around. She was in a light dinner dress, which is not what you wear to space. If you're gonna take your date into, you know, the stratosphere, tell them to bring a jacket. Because it's freezing up there, man.
You okay?
In some recent incarnations, writers and animators have tried to scale down some of Superman's less plausible superpowers in an effort to make the character more science-friendly.
In the 80s, we did a huge revamp on Superman from the ground up. A writer named John Byrne came along and revamped Superman, and at that point, he was really seriously powered down. We wanted him to really be able to break a sweat. We wanted him to not be able to fly through space unaided.
In 1997, Superman the Animated Series showed the last son of Krypton wearing a pressurized spacesuit while traveling through the galaxy.
The thing is, once you write that character for any length of time, you've got to really start pushing the things that he can do. And frankly, that's kind of the fun of the character, too. I mean, he's not, you know, like, everyday man. He's Superman.
But even if the Earthbound laws of physics don't apply to the character of Superman, they still have to apply to the world around him, especially for filmmakers and animators who have to translate the Man of Steel's comic book adventures to the big screen.
This looks like a job for Superman.
In the Max Fleischer cartoons, they actually did a lot of the live-action mimicry, and a lot of care was taken to the physical logic. For instance, a train trestle will be broken, and Superman will catch the front of the train and carry it over. And instead of just kind of help the train over, he'll slip to the caboose and catch the caboose and make sure it gets set on the tracks, because the reality is you can't just land a train. It's in segments. It's going to go all over the place.
For the scene in Superman Returns, in which Superman rescues a falling airliner, director Bryan Singer and writers Michael Dougherty and Dan Harris made sure to show their hero putting up a tough fight that is as science plausible as it is spectacular.
He is fighting against gravity and physics. And so if he's trying to save a jet and he's holding onto the edge of a wing, it's not easy.
The wing gets very stressed and it ends up breaking off. The reality is, the last thing that's probably ever going to happen on a commercial airplane is your wing's going to break off. But we managed to get a hold of a 747 wing stress test, where they built a series of hydraulics that would bend the wing to its breaking point.
We put the plane into a flat spin, sort of reflecting footage that we saw. When Superman grabs the wing, he can't overcome the centrifugal force to get it to fly straight. And they see the wing bending and failing through here. And then it's a catastrophic error on Superman's part, and you see the plane go immediately into a spin.
You created more of a challenge, I think, by drawing on that idea that he does have to fight against physics.
Of course, catching falling airliners is one thing, but time travel is something else entirely. At the end of Superman the movie, our hero arrives too late to save Lois after a major earthquake. But the Man of Steel has an ace up his super sleeve. He turns back time by reversing the rotation of the planet. Now here's where even some very forgiving scientists accuse Superman of going too far when it comes to breaking the laws of physics.
It would take the power of a very large nuclear power plant running for 100 times the age of the universe to give you enough power to rotate it backwards.
Unfortunately, even if you could reverse the Earth's rotation, that wouldn't reverse time.
That trick just doesn't work. As far as we know of no way to reverse time, although scientists are always looking.
Doing any research in real science would have been a detriment to the creative process. We had Superman turning the world backwards. Now, I'm science knowledgeable enough to know we'd all fly off into space and there would be total destruction of the world. But if we say the world can go backwards, then the world can turn backwards.
There's telephone poles falling all over the road. I'm almost killed and they topped the whole thing off. This stupid car runs out of gas.
Oh,
Well, sorry about that, Lois. But I've been kind of busy for a while.
Okay, so maybe Superman's taken a few liberties with scientific fact over the years. But there's one amazing time he was so right on the money, the U.S. government actually stepped in and covered it up. During World War II, newspaper strips showed the Man of Steel fighting evil scientists who'd done the seemingly impossible. They'd split the atom in order to create an atomic bomb. The strip ran just as scientists on the top secret Manhattan Project were at work on the real thing.
The fellows at the project were flipping out because they're opening up their morning newspaper over their coffee and there's Superman dealing with something that they're dealing with in a secret lab deep under the Nevada desert. And so the feds came to the offices and said, you know, we kind of need you to put this on the shelf for a while because you're so much on the cutting edge of technology that this is a national security risk.
By now, it should be obvious that Superman has no shortage of superpowers. But don't forget, he's also got one big weakness. One that has a fascinating real-life parallel right here on Earth.
I can't come into this room because of the kryptonite. You know that. Jimmy, I want you to try and kick it into the fireplace. Good boy, Jimmy. Now watch out.
Luckily for any writer who has to put conflict in a Superman story, there's one thing that can bring the Man of Steel to his knees. Kryptonite. A radioactive piece of Superman's home planet. Apparently, it's the only substance in the universe which can rob the Man of Steel of his powers. And, depending on the exposure, potentially kill him.
It immediately puts him back on Krypton, where people don't fly, people don't have super strength. It makes him just like us.
Kryptonite basically brings him back to zero, and therefore vulnerable to everything, which is a problem if you're supposedly super, because then being normal all over again kind of sucks. But there are multiple types of kryptonite. And they all have different effects on him. There's the normal green kryptonite, there's red kryptonite. Some of them affect him psychologically, others affect him physically, and it's because it's the radiation from his own planet that really throws a monkey wrench in his whole system.
But what makes a little chunk of meteor from Krypton so dangerous?
It's deadly. Damn.
And why doesn't it affect the rest of us?
Perhaps kryptonite emits radiation in a wavelength band that's just unhealthy for Superman, just like uranium and radium do for us, as we can see in this Geiger counter right here. Every beep we hear is a cosmic ray that is scrambling my DNA as we speak. One or two beeps aren't going to harm us. If I brought this near a radioactive source like radium or uranium, this thing would go mad.
Of course, a little radiation in a controlled environment can be a good thing. Just think of microwave ovens. But too much radiation can be deadly.
The harm we get from radioactive materials is basically, at a simple level, damage to the molecules in there. It rips bonds, it breaks molecules apart, and if it breaks the wrong ones apart, your cells stop working or you get sick.
But unlike radioactive materials on Earth, kryptonite doesn't take years or even days to hurt Superman. Its effects are instantaneous.
Dad, I feel kind of strange.
The reason kryptonite affects him so quickly from a writer's standpoint is because I don't have 22 pages to sit around watching him slowly turn green. I really want the dramatic impact right off the bat.
But of all his amazing abilities, Superman does have one superpower you won't find in the comic books or on screen. It's the power he's had for over 60 years to get readers and audiences interested in the concepts of science.
Once the effects of the solar flare faded, everything went back to normal.
Superman was certainly an influence in my life. I studied Superman on television. I studied Superman comic books. and the kind of questions that Superman raised certainly helped me to become a scientist.
I was heavily into comics and science fiction. Superman especially, because Superman is basically a science fiction character. He comes from another planet, he's an alien, he has these amazing abilities. And in some ways he personifies a lot of very important scientific issues.
Today, Superman's influence can be seen in laboratories around the world, where X-ray vision and super strength aren't just reserved for superheroes.
How do you like that? Just like Superman. Come on, Miss Lane!
The world's definitely catching up to Superman. I mean, the next time you go to the airport, take a look at the new fluoroscopes they've got going. They can actually see through your clothing to make sure that you're not carrying anything. That's X-ray vision in its purest form.
Humans can also wear bulletproof vests made from Kevlar. A synthetic fiber which, according to tests, is 5 times stronger than steel.
The bullets bounce off just like Superman.
That's because we are like Superman.
In 2004, researchers at the University of Pennsylvania announced their use of genetic engineering to develop what they called super mice. The experiment resulted in mice more resistant to injury and disease than their normal counterparts.
If they were hurt, they would heal incredibly fast. Their stamina was much better than normal mice. Genetically engineering humans is much more complicated than mice, but there's no reason to think that we won't be able to do it someday, and actually fairly soon.
As we understand the biological mechanisms better, it is possible that we can turn on and turn off elements of our genetic expression to give us advanced powers. We can change our genetic expression, not necessarily our DNA, but the expression of this DNA on what is produced may give us superhuman qualities.
Golly, Mr. Kent, you'll never know how wonderful it is to be like Superman.
Fortunately, you don't need a degree from Metropolis University to see that some of the science behind Superman's amazing powers isn't so far-fetched after all.
Superman and his powers have inspired science and technology by showing physicists and scientists what's possible.
It's Superman!
Perhaps what's not possible, but good science fiction always drives good science fact.
Superman very early on instilled a deep love of science that I've tried to bring then back to the comics as I write them, try to write them with the reality of science in mind as best you can.
Gee, could you teach me to do that?
Mommy, there's something I want you to remember. No one, but no one can do the things that Superman does. And that goes especially for flying. Now answer my question. Who do you think I am?
You're Superman.
At the end of the day, maybe Superman's real superpower isn't his super strength. His X-ray vision, his super hearing, or even his ability to fly. It's the fact that Superman is really just the ultimate good guy. A superhero, not because of what he can do, but because of who he is.
Superman embodies all the qualities that we want to have in humanity, perhaps more than any other comic book figure.
Superman is a positive force, and when he uses science, you always know he's going to be using his science for good.
Like any other citizen of the planet, I must obey the law.
We need someone like that. We need Superman like we need heroes. Superman was just born that way.
I'm here to fight for truth and justice in the American way.
The spirit of Superman has always existed and always will exist. The pinnacle of human existence, I think, is if everyone could be Superman, then the world would be a better place.
some bad hat, Harry.